Our ultimate goal was to have a complete full-range directivity control from 50 Hz to 20 kHz.
Having a proper directivity means that the frequency response on-axis and off-axis is pretty similar, focusing the sound to where you want it. And of course, it's not our intention to annoy neighbors.
To improve the performance and the predictability of that, this is what more art and less noise in the back means.
You switch on a conventional system and the reverberant field kind of grows up in the room, and then you switch over to the new system with its broadband directivity, and from the very first moment you are there.
It's that particular moment where you walk a room and the sound just doesn't go out of balance, even if you are way out of the nominal coverage. And it's just you stand there and then you think, oh my God.
And in the end, I think the result is really outstanding.
And this is what the SL theory is about. So, D&B, the GSL systems. Let's talk about acoustical targets in terms of achievable headroom, achievable output, and the broadband directivity.
The major requirement was to increase the low frequency headroom. So we could state minimum 6 dB, that's what we want to have.
Around 50, 60 Hz.
Around 50, 60 Hz, so in the low frequency range. Then in the low mid range, compared to what we have already with existing systems, that's not much that we need to improve. Of course, it's always better to have than to need. The same applies for the high mid-frequency range. And then, of course, there's the high-frequency range. That's the range above approximately 4 or 5 kilohertz. This is where we have to increase as much as possible in order to cope with the mid-range projection that the ray processing can offer.
It has to do with air absorption and reaching far distance.
Of course, if we want to reach long distances, we have to compensate a lot of air absorption. And this means every headroom you can achieve in the high frequency range is very welcome.
Mm. That's quite high targets to accomplish, but
of course, we have to be realistic here. Approximately 3 to 4 dB, this is something what we can achieve if we add a third HF driver.
More art, less noise, talking about broadband directivity and performance difference and assets to it. As we pointed out a lot of times, emission, transmission and emission on the neighbors is a big topic. And our aim was to keep the art to where it belongs and to keep the neighbors safe, which applies for any outdoor situation, open air situation.
Indoors, we have another problem. Of course, large arenas, they show a tremendous amount of low frequency reverberation time. Imagine you have a situation like this, a show in the round where you have several arrays, and imagine one of these arrays is pointing at you and serves the area where you are located. So this separation between all these arrays works pretty well in the mid and high frequency range, but towards lower frequencies, you hear the contribution of all the arrays that are placed in the arena. And of course, the energy contribution from all the others comes at a complete weird time. The effect is that the low frequencies are kind of building up a lot of energy in the room, and it's really mudding up and you have a strange sound. So if we analyze where this comes from, we could have a look at this picture here. This is an omnidirectional subwoofer array. This is basically where we come from in the low frequency range. So if you replace the omnidirectional subwoofers by directional subwoofers, where we have several different solutions, we achieve pretty much what we want to. We remove the part of the energy that's emitted to the rear side and manage to concentrate the energy to the audience area. Well, if we look at higher frequencies of a top cabinet on this diagram here,
basically 300 hertz.
It's approximately, it's a frequency range above approximately 300 hertz, where we could claim we have a proper directivity. Again, we can see this frequency range concentrates the energy on the audience area and minimizes it towards the rear. So again, the situation here is pretty well under control. If we turn to the other picture, this one here, this represents the same array in a frequency range below this magic 300 hertz transition area. What do we see here? We have some emission to the front where we want to have it, where the audience is located, out. But we have nearly the same amount of energy towards the rear, which means a lot of noise where we don't want to have some noise. If we express this behavior well slightly differently in an isobar form, this here on this side is a subwoofer frequency range, so from 30 Hz to 100 Hz, roughly the subwoofer frequency range. On this axis you can see the angles, so there is the 0 degree axis in the center, and towards, well, downwards and upwards, it's the angle around the box. So you can see, well, towards the rear, the level is decreasing nicely, and that's the behavior of a cardioid subwoofer. If you look at a top cabinet, frequency range starting from 30 Hz going to 20 kHz, we can see if we start from the higher frequencies, there is a nice control until a certain frequency range below approximately 300 Hz, where it suddenly starts to open up and we are entering a kind of omnidirectional dispersion there. Of course, this behavior changes a little bit with the size of the box, but that's not much. What actually happens, it's a few tens of hertz up and down, but it's nothing significantly different. So, what do we learn from that?
This exactly is the frequency area and the frequency band, which in the outdoor situation fills up the offside noise measurements in an energy point of view, and in the indoor situations creates that big reverb and the muddy low-mid sound. And this is our target area for the broadband directivity from the top cabinets.
Okay, how did we achieve this broadband directivity?
To the setup of the cabinet and the cardioid behavior of the low end, which you might lead through quickly.
Well, the cardioid principle that is applied here relies on the same principle and the same basics that we use with the subwoofers. It's basically creating a certain path length difference between multiple sources and applying an appropriate processing function to the individual components. And if you do this right, you can create a nice dispersion pattern.
Full coherency to the front?
This is an additional thing. If you do it right, you can achieve a full coherency towards the front and a nice rejection to the rear. Again, this is where we're coming from. Below a certain frequency range, we are kind of losing our directivity and we are opening up to omnidirectional, and applying this principle to the new system means that we can maintain the directivity towards the lowest frequencies.
And that's basically what we've been dreaming for decades from a full range cabinet. Basically, perfect isobars over the entire frequency band.
Exactly.
This is taken from the noise calc simulation softwares where we can actually simulate emission.
Well, this is a slice in the low frequency range and it shows a comparison between a J-series array and a GSL array.
And it's basically the same arrays with the same reference level at the reference point.
And what we see here, we have in the low frequency range basically no rejection to the rear. We have identical emission basically all around, while with the new system we have a similar high level towards the audience area and a massive rejection to the rear.
The rejection is about 12 to 15 dB in the whole area, which is really, really impressive. So this is our solution to what we think is one of the very, very important factor in the future of open air live reinforcement, to control and to reduce emission very drastically. And it's part of the entire package that comes with the systems. We're talking more about the package and other stuff in the next module.